Joining us right now to chat about all of this and more, Dr. Raywat Deenanandan, an epidemiologist and science communicator at the University of Ottawa. Hello, welcome back.
Hello.
So Ottawa is in the orange zone, but as we can see from the numbers, it looks like we are inching closer to the red zone. What's your personal perception of our numbers today?
Exactly that. We are inching up and we're scratching that threshold. I think we're going to get there because things are opening up and people are increasing their contacts. And as well, the new variants are among us. Now, the thing about the new variants is we need a critical mass of them before they start becoming a real problem. And it looks like we're approaching that critical mass in high density areas like Toronto. And in the UK, we saw that this variant was able to achieve exponential growth even during lockdown. So it seems likely that we're going to be experiencing some growth very soon.
So you think we'll dip into the red zone?
I think we will, yeah. But, you know, I'm not an oracle. Many things could happen. We may be able to vaccinate ahead of the time. We never know. But it seems that absent getting ahead of the vaccination curve, that seems likely.
Okay. And how quickly do you think that could happen?
Oh, I have no idea. It could take weeks. It might already be there, who knows? But it comes down to, again, the extent to which we are observing our number of contacts. And our contact rate has increased. So it went from like 1.2 before things were lifted to 5.8. I think now we're approaching 6. So if that contact rate increases, then it becomes more likely.
That seems like a really important metric to keep an eye on, the contact rate. You know, we look at the case counts, we look at the positivity rate, but I think you keep coming back to that one because that's indicative of how much social contact people are having, right?
That's exactly right. This is all a function of human behavior. So can we measure human behavior? A little bit. And this is one metric we use to determine that.
Does that contact rate just mean people that you're in close contact with, aka if I have you over and you're in my living room and we're unmasked? Or is that if I have you over and you're in the backyard far away from me?
That's a really good question. I'm not really sure. I suspect it's the first. It depends on how the public health unit defines it.
The Ottawa-Carleton District School Board is calling on the province to prioritize teachers for vaccinations. And not just teachers, I should say, education workers. The chair of the board, Lynn Scott, has written this open letter to the education minister. And in it, she is asking the provincial government to recognize the immediate need to prioritize education workers. What do you think of that?
Everyone has a rationale for wanting their group ahead of the line, right? And we can prioritize individuals according to risk of death, risk of hospitalization, risk of exposure, and risk of infection. Everybody agrees that risk of death is high on the list. That's why the elderly in the long-term care center visits are high on the list. Risk according to risk of infection is important. That's why doctors and nurses are up there. But risk of exposure is probably the third tier. And risk of exposure is people who have multiple contacts as a daily event, like teachers, bus drivers, grocery clerks, those sorts of people. So it makes a kind of sense. However, I will say that I think you get your bigger bang for your buck if you focus on the community as a whole and stratify by age. So start with the community living elderly and gradually go down by age. But I definitely see the argument, especially if you're going to put school opening as a priority. If you're going to list schools as an essential service, as some think we should, then the individuals who run the schools should be essential workers, therefore should be prioritized.
Why do you get a bigger bang for your buck? Because people who are older tend to be at more serious high risk of being hospitalized?
Yeah, it depends on what your goal is. If the goal is to reduce the burden on the healthcare system, which is what we think the goal always has been, then that's what you do. So it seems that a third wave is likely. And what is unclear, though, is whether that third wave will result in just an increased number of cases or also an increased number of hospitalizations and deaths. The way we avoid the hospitalizations and deaths is by vaccinating strategically. We probably can't avoid the cases unless we get really ahead of the curve vaccination-wise. So it strikes me that, again, if the goal here is to avoid measurable human suffering, then you harden those most likely to suffer. If we had enough vaccine, I would say do it by risk. So it strikes me that age makes more sense.
Though potentially, and I say this as a hypothetical, potentially if you had the supply of vaccinations, you could do both simultaneously.
Yes, that would be the ideal, right? And that's what we should strive for.
A lot of family doctors are complaining that they're getting calls from patients asking, when can I come in and get the COVID-19 vaccination? But they say they haven't been notified, so they don't know. What's your sense of when doctors will be administering the vaccine?
As you know, I live with one, a doctor, not a vaccine, and she's similarly frustrated because the doctors are not getting any guidance from the government on what to do. So it was kind of dropped on their laps by a press conference that the family doctors are in charge of this, but they've been given no guidance. So it's all up in the air. It depends on when the vaccine task force will lay out a plan for how doctors will be able to schedule these things. Now, some public health units around the province have set up online vaccination scheduling systems. It appears to be a municipality by municipality function, best I can tell. It really should be a provincial issue, but it isn't. So whenever we get that sorted out locally is when we will know. And then hopefully family doctors can tap into that online system and direct their patients that way.
Some critics have accused the government of downloading the responsibility of planning and administering the vaccine onto municipalities. Does it make sense, in your view, for public health units locally to handle that aspect of the vaccination campaign overall?
I think it does. If anyone has experience and the ability to manage vaccination campaigns, it's the people who do this every year, and that's public health units. In fact, one public health unit manager was saying that their team is chomping at the bit to do this. Just give them the vaccines and the resources, and they will make it happen. But you have to give them the vaccines and the resources and time to prepare. So hopefully that communication process is happening in the background.
The AstraZeneca review is in the final stages of approval in Canada. Health Canada says it's in discussion with the vaccine maker over labeling. But as we're talking about this here, the EU, the UK and Australia have already approved it. What's going on? What's the holdup?
I don't know what the holdup is necessarily, but I know that there is some concern that the AstraZeneca dose is not effective against B1351, that's the South African variant. We're not as effective. And so there's some concern that why deploy it widely if we're going to have to re-booster everyone if that variant becomes dominant. But there's something to be said for allowing a new product into the market to give everyone immunity against the dominant strains and then deploying boosters later on. So it might just be a matter of strategizing what the appropriate use of this vaccine will be. So I'm not sure what the holdup is at the governmental level. It might be something minor, like how to label it, exactly what kind of dosage to give. That's another issue too, by the way. So the clinical trial data is kind of all over the map when it comes to the AstraZeneca dose. They had some dosing issues on the trial, and now it seems that a separation between the two doses of a longer period of time is beneficial, and that's based on unpublished data that I haven't seen. So they're probably going through and weighing these various sources of data before making a determination.
Dr. Theresa Tam, Canada's top doctor, said earlier today we could potentially lift some COVID-19 restrictions even before the September vaccination deadline, because, you know, we've got the vaccinations that are coming out, hopefully more and more that are coming into the country, and then also spring weather pushing people outdoors. And she was saying things should start looking up, but it depends on the vaccine rollout and the variants. What did you make of those comments?
She's exactly right. So things will start getting better gradually the second we reach certain thresholds. It's hard to say what those thresholds will be, but we don't have to reach exactly herd immunity to notice a difference. We start getting herd effects when the right people become immune. And we'll start seeing that again when we get sufficient dose. But the new variants are the great confounder. And this is why there's such a call from people like me to slow down the opening up, because we want to keep the variants in check while we achieve vaccination. If we let the variants get a foothold in our community, then we got to open things up more slowly again, right? So there's no point giving it an advantage when we don't need to. So it's hard to make a prediction for the future with that great unknown. Well, two great unknowns: vaccine availability and the presence and spread of the new variants.
So we are in the orange zone right now, and as you mentioned, our numbers are getting a little bit uncomfortably close to the red, but things are reopened. We have gyms open, restaurants open, and, you know, we also have the Outaouais, which is right across the bridge. They're reopened to a degree. It's not the same as us. We have different regulations. For example, you can have four people at a table here. You can only have two there, and they all have to be from the same household and from the region. And so, you know, when I was chatting with a Gatineau City Councillor yesterday, Mike Duggan, he said it doesn't really make sense to him. He said we should probably have synchronized our public health measures, given the fact that this is one big region. He also mentioned that he's okay with people going across the bridge because, you know, people live here and work there and vice versa. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, it's complicated. Our regional administrative framework is going to be the weakness in how we respond to public health concerns, whether it's federal, provincial, municipal, or a combination thereof. So it strikes me that if you're going to have the free flow of people across the jurisdictions, of course, you have to have some sort of concatenation, synchronization policies. Otherwise, you have to enact some sort of domestic travel restrictions, maybe even have people checked on the bridges to make sure they actually live across the border, you know, that kind of approach. But yeah, it makes sense to me. But none of that's going to happen. So the best we can hope for is a maximum distribution of vaccine quickly and that people act in their own recognizance to self-limit their contacts.
The thing is, though, right now, when you look at the numbers, the positivity rate, as well the R value, the cases, none of that is linked to the reopening in the orange, right? This is too quickly. This would have been linked to behavior and activity before.
That's right. Now, we're almost there. It's getting close to it. The contact numbers are probably more recent. But therefore, as the opening happens, those numbers are going to increase from a fairly high baseline. So that's why I think we hit red soon.
But the hope is that they stay stable-ish, that, you know, maybe they're up, but they don't go really up. There's not a huge spike up.
There's a lot of randomness in this, and that doesn't make people happy to hear, but this is not an exact science, and I think everybody understands now. There's stochasticity, as we call it, built into the system. And there are things like maybe there's seasonality effects, you know, maybe individuals choose to self-limit in an unpredictable fashion. You can't say for sure. But to the extent that we can make predictions, it seems that we're on the verge of moving into red, and it would not surprise me if we get there. But at the same time, it wouldn't surprise me if we don't. I mean, this disease has shown us to never be content with what we think we know.
Mm-hmm. Who knows if we can hold steady where we are. Dr. Rewat Dhiyanandhan, not an oracle, as he stresses, and I appreciate that, but an epidemiologist, and we always appreciate your perspective. So thank you for joining us, and thank you for giving it.
Thank you.
Dr. Rewat Dhiyanandhan.